speak up.
Chapter 3. Monsieur Madeleine. One winter's evening, a toothless woman with a grey face and flowers in her hair was arrested for attacking a man in the street. She was taken to the police station, where Inspector Javert, the chief of police, sent her to prison for 6 months.
"Please, Monsieur Javert,"
the woman fell to her knees.
"I owe 100 francs. If I don't pay, my little girl will lose her home and be thrown out onto the streets. Please, don't send me to prison."
Javert listened to her coldly, then ordered a policeman to take her away. While the policeman was trying to drag her to her feet, however, a voice from the shadows said, "One moment, please." Javert looked up and saw Monsieur Madeleine, one of the most important people in the town. Monsieur Madeleine had arrived mysteriously in Montreuil one December evening in 1815. He had no money, but he had a revolutionary idea. He knew a cheap and efficient method of manufacturing glass. Within a few months of his arrival, thanks to his new idea, the glassmaking factory in Montreuil was making enormous profits. With the money he made, Monsieur Madeleine built 2 new factories, which provided the town with hundreds of new jobs. He became a very wealthy man, but lived a simple life, using most of his money to build new hospitals and schools. He was so popular that in 1820, the townspeople elected him mayor of Montreuil. There was one man, however, who did not like Monsieur Madeleine. This was the chief of police, Inspector Javert. He had always been suspicious of Monsieur Madeleine, and was sure that he had seen him somewhere before, many years earlier. But he kept his suspicions to himself, not daring to say what he really believed, that Monsieur Madeleine was, in fact, a dangerous criminal with a terrible past. Now, years later, Monsieur Madeleine was in the police station, trying to save Fantine from prison. Fantine, however, was not grateful. In fact, when she saw who it was, she spat at him.
"You own the factory where I used to work," she shouted at him. "I lost my job because of you. Now, I've become a bad woman. But what choice did I have? I'll never get my daughter back if I don't make money."
The mayor turned to Inspector Javert and said in a soft, firm voice, "This woman must be released."
"That's impossible," Javert replied. "She attacked a man in the street, a respectable citizen. And now I've just seen her spit at you, the mayor of our town. A woman like this deserves to be punished."
"But I saw what happened in the street just now," Monsieur Madeleine said. "It was the man's fault, not this woman's. You should arrest him, not her." Javert argued with Monsieur Madeleine for some time, but finally gave in. He walked angrily out of the room, leaving the mayor and the prostitute alone together. Fantine trembled, as confused as Javert had been. The man who had just saved her from prison was also the man who had caused all her troubles. The devil had suddenly decided to be kind, and she did not know what to think. "I heard what you said," Monsieur Madeleine said to her. "I honestly didn't know that you had lost your job. But I'll try to help you now. I'll pay your debts and arrange for your child to return to you. I'll give you all the money you need. I'll make you happy again. And I promise that in the eyes of God, you have never been a bad woman. Fantine gazed at Monsieur Madeleine with tears in her eyes. After all her pain and suffering, she had, for the first time in her life, found kindness in another human being. At last, she would be cared for, and she could look forward to a life of happiness with Cosette. Without a word, she fell to her knees and kissed the back of Monsieur Madeleine's hand. Monsieur Madeleine sent the Thénardiers 300 francs and told them to send Cosette to Montreuil immediately. Thénardier, thinking that Fantine had suddenly become rich, wrote back and demanded 500 francs. Monsieur Madeleine sent the money, but the Thénardiers found even more dishonest excuses for not sending Cosette back. The weeks passed, and although she was happier than she had been for a long time, Fantine caught a fever. Months of poverty and misery had made her ill, and she soon became so weak that she was unable to leave her bed.
"When shall I see Cosette?"
she kept asking Monsieur Madeleine when he visited her. "Very soon," he would reply, and her pale face would light up with joy. One morning, as Monsieur Madeleine was making preparations to leave for Montfermeil and to fetch Cosette himself, he had a visitor. Inspector Javert walked into his office and stood in silence, waiting for him to look up from his work. "Well, Javert, what is it?" Monsieur Madeleine finally said.
"I've come to apologize, Monsieur Madeleine," the inspector replied.
"What are you talking about?"
"I've treated you unjustly. I was angry with you 6 weeks ago when you told me to release that woman. I wrote to the police headquarters in Paris and told them about you."
"Told them what about me?"
"Forgive me, Monsieur Madeleine, but I believed you were a man called Jean Valjean. He was a prisoner I saw 20 years ago when I worked at a prison in Toulon. After being released from prison, this Valjean stole some silver from the Bishop of Digne and robbed a small boy on a public footpath. We tried to catch him, but he disappeared. When you arrived in Montreuil, I felt sure that you were this man. But now, I know I was wrong, and I'm sorry. You will, of course, dismiss me from my job, as I've shown that I don't deserve your trust."
Monsieur Madeleine, looking hard at Javert without expression, said quietly, "I'm afraid I don't understand."
"The police headquarters in Paris told me that Jean Valjean was arrested last autumn for stealing apples," Javert explained. "He'd changed his name to Jean Mathieu and had lived for several years in the village of Aïlo-Cloche. Two ex-prisoners from Toulon recognized him as Jean Valjean. I visited the man in Arras prison, and I saw for myself that he is indeed Jean Valjean. Of course, he denies everything, but that's not surprising. If he's found guilty of stealing from the bishop, who, as you know, died a couple of years ago, and of robbing the small boy, he'll spend the rest of his life in prison."
Monsieur Madeleine looked down at his papers. "This matter is of no interest to me, Javert," he said casually. "I'm sure you have other work to do."
"I was going to the man's trial in Arras tomorrow," Javert said. "But after this conversation, you must dismiss me."
Monsieur Madeleine rose to his feet. "Javert," he said, "you're an honorable man. You made one small mistake, that's all. I want you to continue your excellent work as inspector of police." He offered Javert his hand, but the inspector refused to take it. Instead, he said,
"I've behaved unjustly towards an innocent man. I cannot shake his hand."
With those words, he bowed and left the office, leaving Monsieur Madeleine to stare at the papers on his desk with an empty, puzzled look in his eyes. That afternoon, Monsieur Madeleine visited Fantine. She had a high fever and was coughing badly, but she still had only one thing on her mind.
Cosette?
She asked him. Very soon, he assured her. He sat by her bed for an hour, and then, having told the nurses to look after her, he returned to his home. He stayed awake all night, thinking of Javert's story about Champmathieu. The reader has probably already realized that Monsieur Madeleine was really Jean Valjean, and Monsieur Madeleine, as we shall continue to call him for this part of the story, knew that he could not let Champmathieu go to prison for crimes he had not committed. He knew, although he was not happy to admit this, that he would have to go to Arras and tell the truth. He would lose everything that he had worked so hard to achieve. He would also have to break his promise to Fantine about bringing Cosette from Montfermeil. But what choice did he have? The truth was more important than anything else. The next morning, Monsieur Madeleine set off on the long journey to Arras. It took him more than 12 hours. And when he arrived, he discovered that Champmathieu's trial had already started. The courtroom was full, but because he was such an important man, Monsieur Madeleine was allowed to sit behind the judge's chair. He watched as several witnesses swore on the Bible that the man standing before the judge was Jean Valjean. Champmathieu, a large, simple-minded man, denied everything when his chance came to speak. But the crowd thought he was trying to be funny. The courtroom filled with laughter, and Champmathieu began to laugh himself, which did him no good at all. Finally, having heard all the evidence, the judge called for silence. He was preparing to announce his decision when Monsieur Madeleine, pale and trembling, stood up and said, "That man is not Jean Valjean." An excited whisper went around the courtroom as everybody recognized Monsieur Madeleine. Monsieur Madeleine waited for the whispers to stop before announcing in a loud, clear voice that he was Jean Valjean. At first, no one believed him, but he managed to persuade the court by skillfully questioning each of the witnesses, revealing personal information that only the real Jean Valjean could have known. When he had persuaded the court of the truth of his confession, he was faced with a shocked but respectful silence. "I must leave now," Monsieur Madeleine finally said. "I have important business to attend to. You know where to find me, and I shall not try to escape." Everybody stood to one side to let him pass as he made his way towards the door. When he had gone, the judge immediately allowed Champmathieu to leave the court a free man. Champmathieu went home in a state of total confusion, thinking all men mad and understanding nothing of what had happened. At dawn the next day, Monsieur Madeleine entered Fantine's room. "How is she?" he asked the nurse who was watching her as she slept.
"She seems better. She's looking forward to seeing her child."
"I haven't brought the child with me," Monsieur Madeleine said.
"Then what can we say to her when she wakes up?"
The nurse looked suddenly worried.
"It will destroy her if she doesn't see her child now, after you promised to bring her."
"God will guide me," Monsieur Madeleine sighed. For some time, Monsieur Madeleine sat by the bedside and watched Fantine while she slept. She was breathing with great difficulty, but her face looked peaceful and calm. Suddenly she opened her eyes and saw Monsieur Madeleine.
"Cosette?"
she asked with a soft smile. "Later," Monsieur Madeleine said gently, taking her hand. "You're too weak to see her at the moment. First, you must get well." Fantine smiled and began to talk dreamily about her future life with her daughter and how happy they would be together. But suddenly, her face froze, and she stared with horror at the door. Monsieur Madeleine, who was holding her hand, turned and saw Inspector Javert. Fantine, thinking that the inspector had come for her, gripped Monsieur Madeleine's hand tightly and begged him to protect her. "Don't be afraid," Monsieur Madeleine tried to calm her. "He hasn't come for you." Then, gently rising from his chair, he moved towards Javert. "I know what you've come for," he said quietly so that Fantine wouldn't hear. "But give me 3 days, please. That's all I ask. 3 days to fetch this unfortunate woman's child. I'll pay anything you like." "Do you think I'm stupid?" Javert gave an unpleasant laugh. 3 days to escape, you mean?" Fantine, who had heard what Monsieur Madeleine said despite his efforts to speak quietly, began to tremble.
"To fetch my child?" she cried. "Isn't she here? Nurse, answer me. Where's my little Cosette? I want to see her, Monsieur Madeleine."
"Be quiet, you dirty prostitute," Javert interrupted her angrily. "There is no Monsieur Madeleine. This man's name is Jean Valjean, and he's a criminal no better than you are. And you can forget all that nonsense about your child."
Fantine suddenly sat up. She stared wildly at the two men, then turned to the nurse. She looked as if she was going to speak, but no words came from her lips. Instead, with a small sigh, she fell back against her pillow and lay completely still. Jean Valjean, as we must now call him, shook Javert's hand from his collar and ran to the bed. He gazed into Fantine's eyes and knew immediately that she was dead.
"You've killed her!"
he cried angrily, turning to Javert with a fierce look in his eyes.
"I didn't come here to argue,"
Javert said, stepping back nervously, afraid that Valjean was going to attack him.
"If you don't come with me now, I'll have to call my men."
Valjean looked around the room, thinking for a second of making his escape. But the idea did not last for long. He turned again to Fantine and looked for one last time at her sad, pale face and empty blue eyes. Bending down, he closed her eyes and pressed his lips against her forehead. Then he rose and turned back to Javert. "I'm ready now," he said. News of Monsieur Madeleine's arrest spread quickly around the town. Most people pretended not to be surprised. "We always knew there was something strange about him," they said. 2 days after his arrest, Jean Valjean escaped from prison. The bars of his window had been broken during the night. Again, most people pretended not to be surprised.
"It takes more than a small town prison to hold a man as strong as that," they all agreed.
Thank you for being with us. We'll see you next time for more exciting and helpful videos to help you master your speaking fluency through our listening sessions.